So we've seen in the last video that the diffraction integral for a slit, and indeed any diffraction integral, can be written as a Fourier transform of the aperture function. And this is something we'll explore as we go forward. But if I just recap, if you have a slit in one dimension, you get this sinc squared intensity pattern, as you see here. This is a photograph of the same pattern, which looks very much like the little experiment that I've just shown you. That's the same idea. We saw also that there was no diffraction along the long dimension of the slit. So that this is why the treatment as a one-dimensional problem in the maths was justified, because along the long axis, nothing was happening. The light wasn't constricted. Of course, we could now look also at a diffraction from a rectangular aperture from an opening where you restrict both in X and in Y. And in fact, the pattern looks like two orthogonal sinc patterns, one for the short dimension, so along, so if this is A here and this is B, then the pattern in this direction here would correspond to this short dimension, and the pattern in this direction would correspond to this long dimension. And so you could think of sketching that yourself to see how that might happen. So obviously, along the short dimension, the pattern will be more spaced out, and along the long dimension, it will be more constricted. Because you know, you can now get some kind of an information, an idea of what might be happening, because we have the image, the diffraction pattern, and the aperture function. They are Fourier transform pairs. One is the Fourier transform of the other. That means, of course, that small dimensions in real space become large dimensions in Fourier space, and vice versa, because they're inversely related. Okay, so I mean, you've learned one cool thing so far, I think. First of all, that you know, the light waves can perform Fourier transforms for you. In fact, they perform Fourier transforms faster than anything else in the world. They do it at the speed of light, and they do it accurately. So in fact, we've seen this for the slit. As soon as you throw the light onto it and you fill it with light of a constant phase, then you get, in the Fraunhofer condition, you get a you get a perfect Fourier transform of the system. Okay, so if I don't do this, I mean, you can do this as an exercise yourself, but if I were to look at this rectangular slit here again, if I write this now as a Fourier transform over both dimensions, so you'd have to now do an integral where the field in the aperture is now a function of not just y, but it's now a function of x and y. And you then have to integrate both along the x direction and the y direction here. So we have essentially I ux and plus v y, where each one of those are, where u is k sine theta, where the sine is along the x direction, and v is k sine theta some dashed, if you so want, where that is the variation along the y direction. So this is separable, as you can see, and then you essentially end up with a product. If you do these integrals, you can separate these, and then you end up with a product that looks like that. So you have an intensity pattern, which is sine beta over beta, sinc beta squared, which is exactly what we had for the individual slit, but that's then multiplied by a pattern along the other direction, which corresponds to the other dimension. So I leave that as an exercise to you to work that out. Okay, but we now come to the most important diffraction pattern in microscopy. It's the pattern that leads to the so-called point spread function, which you've already met in the first lecture. And so that is the diffraction pattern we get from a circular aperture. And of course, if you think about it, a microscope lens, a round lens, is nothing else than a circular aperture. It will admit light, but beyond a certain angle, light is not admitted, so we have diffraction because we are constricting the light. The less we constrict it, the better the representation of the object is from which the light emanates and from which the image is formed. That's why we need these large numerical apertures. Large numerical apertures means little diffraction and therefore faithful reproduction of your image, good resolution. Okay, so let's look at Fraunhofer diffraction from a circular aperture. So, and to do the math here, I mean, you are kind of expecting already the result, right? I mean, so we said, okay, the diffraction integral looks like a Fourier transform, so what will happen here? Of course, we will expect the diffraction pattern to be the Fourier transform of the circular aperture. And so you kind of already know what the answer might be. It turns out that for those who've done Fourier transform, a circular top hat function, the Fourier transform of it is a Bessel function. And that's a result we will arrive at now the hard way. And then later on, from the next lecture on, we will just use the known results from Fourier transforms and avoid all the hard math, because we just know once we have a certain aperture function, we just look up what is its Fourier transform, and then we know that that's what we get in the image plane behind the tube lens. So here we are. So I draw a circular aperture, and let me draw it sort of front on. So here we are. So here's an axis to set up the coordinates. So here's a circular aperture. It looks something like this. And so I just to indicate that this is opaque here, so no light coming through. It's only through the circular part that the light comes through. So the center is here. And let's just consider now a strip along this, in this aperture, like so. And this is situated at a position y from the axis here. The radius of the aperture is big R. And so the strip width here is dy. And so this is looking at the aperture front on, so it's obviously illuminated. It's illuminated down with a plane wave, and then we project this onto a screen. We use a lens to get Fraunhofer conditions. So I now draw this also from the side. So if I draw this like so, then from the side the aperture looks like this. Like this. And so we have here now, this is position y. And let's look at what a lens that's situated here. I'm not drawing the lens because by implication we're collecting parallel light rays leaving from the aperture now. So we have this secondary wavelets coming. So let's look at a particular angle theta. Let's look at this angle theta here. So something that leaves for point P at angle theta again, just like we did in the rectangular slit. So all the parallel rays get collected by the tube lens. And so we have this phase difference, y sine theta, just like we had before. So if I look at a particular angle onto this aperture, I can do this, of course, in all directions. But if I look at a particular angle, then what will happen? So if I look as a function of y, then all light from this little strip will arrive with a little phase k r naught y sine theta. So this is r naught, and this is r naught plus y sine theta. But there's a difference, of course, because the strip size is changing. So the amplitude inside this strip, if I sum up all these bits, will be smaller than, let's say, from the central strip, because it's larger, right? So we have to take that into account. So the amplitude, amplitude in strip is proportional to its length, right? So it'll be proportional to its length, L. And the length is given by, so that length here is r squared minus y squared, square root of that. And of course, it's two times that because it's this part and that part, right? So it would be two times r squared minus y squared and the square root of that. So as a function of y, L is decreasing. As y gets to be r, then r squared minus r squared is 0, and then of course L up here is 0. So it and as y is equal to 0, as you require, the strip length is just 2r from this equation, so it makes sense. If I now integrate along y in the way we've drawn this, but of course you could do this along any direction. It doesn't matter which way you do this, but the way we've drawn it now, it's sensible to integrate the light arriving at this angle theta along the y direction. We then get E is equal to a constant minus R to R. So from down here to up there, E to the I k y sine theta. So all the constant factors, these r naughts, are taken out of the integral. So we're not interested in those. But now e of y is proportional to this. So we put that in there. R squared minus y squared times dy. So this is L, and this is the phase term. And so to solve this integral, what you can do, you can let u equals to y over r. Okay, so let's make that substitution. Let's make the substitution u is equal to y over r, and then dy is equal to r times du. And then we make the further substitution of rho is equal to r k sine theta. Let's make that substitution for this. You can get an equation that looks like this. So, but by making these two substitutions, we substitute y of r, so u is proportional to y, r is obviously a constant, and rho is proportional to r k sine theta. So that's proportional to theta. So this is the angle dependence, and this is the y dependence here. Then this integral turns out to be now between minus 1 and 1, right? So because if we integrate, so we write this to be e to the I rho u times 1 minus u squared, which looks much neater than this original integral here. And actually, this is a standard integral. So if y changes from minus r to r, then u changes from minus r over r to plus r over r, so from minus 1 to 1, right? And you can see that rk sine theta times y over r gives you just k sine theta y, which is exactly this part here. So this is correct. I rho u is the same as this. And then 1 minus u squared turns out to be this. And this has a solution. You can look that up. You can look that up in your data book of pi j1 rho over rho, where J1 of rho is a Bessel function of the first kind. And it turns out that J1 of rho over rho, it goes to 1/2 as rho goes to 0. If you look up what the Bessel function is, right, then that's what this does. Now, the important point is that, so if I know this, then I can write for the intensity that I get. The intensity is, of course, the square of the field. So we write that as I is equal to I naught times 2J1 of rho over rho. So that's the same thing as here. The factor of 2 takes into account just, so we normalize the central peak to 1. And so I naught is the incoming intensity of onto that you have inside the aperture, and it's that squared. Okay, so what does that look like? Turns out that the first zero appears at rho equals 3.832. And then the way we've defined rho, just to go back, rho is equal to r times k sine theta. So that means that rho, if I k is 2 pi over lambda, so we have rho equals k r sine theta, and therefore that is equal to 2 pi over lambda r theta. So for small sines, for small angles here, the sine theta is equal to theta. And so we end up with, 2 times r is d. 2 times r is the diameter of the aperture. So if you put that in there, so we get d times theta over lambda equals, that is equal to 3.832. And so if you take 3.832 divided by pi, this is equal to 1.22 roughly, right? Or theta equals 1.22 lambda over d. And this is the first minimum, right, that occurs. And this occurs, of course, again, because we use a lens. So what will we do? We'll put a lens here at the end. And we look, so this could be the tube lens, right? And so if you look at the screen, a distance f away from here, then this would appear at position f times theta. So occurs again at f times theta. Okay, so it is equal to 1.22 f lambda over d from central axis. Okay, so if I look at this, then plotting this function looks something like that. If I now take the intensity again, I've squared, right? So then the actual function, so it's I over I naught is what I plot here, and I plot rho down here, and then at 3.832, I get my first minimum, something like that, and it will do something like that. It starts ringing. And you get subsidiary minima here. And so the first minimum appears here. And actually the first secondary maximum here has an intensity of only about 2% of the main intensity. So it decreases quite rapidly. But you get these rings outside. And of course this width here this width will be proportional to the size of the aperture. The smaller that d is, the larger that distribution. So what you end up getting is a something that's spreading out, and of course this central thing is called the airy disk. And D is the entrance pupil of the microscope objective. And so here you see now the problem of diffraction. I may have a system. Let me just now draw a microscope. So we have you have the objective lens, you have the sample plane. It is one objective difference away. Then we have, this is FO again. And then we have the tube lens. And then we have the image. So that's FT, FT. And what you now see is that a point source, the objective turns this into a plane wave. The aperture is essentially the size of that lens, right? And then, so I'm clipping the light. So because, you know, I'm not capturing light that's outside. This light is not captured. So I'm clipping here with this aperture. And then I get an image here. And the image is essentially the Fourier transform of that. So it's a Bessel function. You get your sinc function here. That looks exactly like this. So each point now isn't a point, but it's spread into an airy disk, into this Bessel function or point spread function. And so so the smaller this aperture is, the wider this becomes. And then you have a problem. Now imagine if I have another point next to it, as I mentioned earlier, if I have another point next to it, that other point will give you another airy function. And if these merged, if they come close enough, if they come closer than lambda over 2NA, so if that's little d, then the airy disks start merging to such a degree that you cannot distinguish them from one another. And that is what the resolution is, right? So if you... I leave this now up to you to work this out. But if I define the resolution if I define the microscope resolution such that the maximum the point spread function from one point falls onto minimum of adjacent point, then I say my resolution, my microscope resolves the resolution. And so I can therefore write, so if to just draw this, so here's one. This is one point. It leads to a Bessel function like this, a point spread function like this, and then the other point, its maximum lies on the minimum here. And we say when the distance between the two points that correspond to these two airy patterns, if that in the image plane, in the sample plane, if that distance between the two points corresponds to this separation, maximum of one lies on the minimum of the other, we say they are resolved. And you can then see that that is equal to R equals from the from what we've just derived, lambda over NA, and that is equal to 1.22 lambda over 2NA. And I leave that to you to work that out from what we've just derived. But just to ram home what we are doing, in the microscope, an object emits light from lots of different points. According to Huygens now, we look at the image plane, what phases do they arrive at to get the image pattern, the field pattern at the image plane. And because the objective is one focal distance away from the object, we have each point will be emitting spherical waves that are converted into plane waves. And so we have Fraunhofer conditions because the tube lens now takes these plane waves from this aperture. The aperture is essentially the size of the input lens. And it takes all these plane waves and it will collect all the parallel light rays that come from each point in this aperture and put them onto a point on the detector. And by adding up the phases correctly, we get the image pattern. And depending on whether the aperture is large or small, we obtain contrast between two points. We resolve them because the patterns that we get, the diffraction patterns, are sufficiently separate so that we see the two blobs separately. But if they start merging with one another, the point spread functions overlap and we can't distinguish the two points anymore. And that gives image blur and loss of resolution. Okay, so that's the concept. And so finally, so it turns out that, you know, these planes, image plane, back focal plane, so we call this the sample plane. This is the back focal plane of the objective. And that's the image plane.
So in this system, the sample plane and the back focal plane are Fourier planes to one another. And the back focal plane and the image plane are also Fourier planes to one another. In contrast, the sample plane and the image plane are called conjugate planes. Conjugate planes meaning that they contain similar information.